Dream. Yes, good morning, everyone. Welcome to the show. It's your pal Howard, Robin, Fred, and gang, Gary. All your friends are here. Hey-o.
I got to tell you one last Prince story.
Yeah, go ahead.
So I was invited to perform during,
funny already.
All-Star Weekend.
Yeah.
It was in Minneapolis. Right. And, you know, Prince wants you to perform at his club. He had this club. I forget what the club's name was. So right. I go in there to meet Prince. And his, like, road manager, these guys pick me up. So this has to be 95, maybe. Pick me up. They take me. I'm like, where's Prince? And they said, well, he's not here. And I'm like, fuck. That's the only reason why I did the gig.
Right.
So they said, well, I'm like, fuck. All right, here we go. So they toured me all around Paisley Park. You know, at that point, that was farmland.
Right.
Now it's like a suburb. But at that time, there were cornfields. And he had bought this property and built this studio. And it was incredible. I mean, there's right. an apartment.
State of the art. Yeah. Yeah.
So the guy tells me this story. And he said that one time they were on the road and Prince calls him at 3 a.m. And he said, that's not unusual because Prince was known to go. He would call in and he'd say, I'm going to do a rehearsal. You know, 3 a.m. So he said 3 a.m. and he answers the phone. He says, what's up? In a hotel on the road. And he says, that motherfucking voice is coming from the motherfucking walls. And he's like, motherfucker, you better come to my room. So he goes to Prince's room. Yeah. He knocks on the door. Prince opens it up. 3 a.m. He has white satin pajamas, white satin do-rag, full perm, makeup, and white satin high heel boots.
Oh my God.
And he says, dude, what's going on? I told you, man, this motherfucking voice is coming from the motherfucking walls. And so he comes in the room and he says, okay, Prince, what is going on? He said, motherfucker, listen. So they're quiet and they hear this voice.
Coming from the wall.
A female voice. So he calls the hotel security. They call the police. They do a complete sweep. They find this woman who is in the crawl space behind Prince's bed with a flashlight and a Bible. Oh. And she's reading Bible verse to try and convert Prince.
Oh, my God.
Oh, my God. So it was for real.
It was absolutely for real. So he said, as they were dragging this woman screaming out, Prince is sitting at the table with his legs crossed, and he says, I told you, motherfuckers, there were motherfucking voices coming from the motherfucking walls, but y'all motherfuckers didn't believe. So that was the story.
Wow.
Yeah.
Ladies, what would your man say is your biggest turn on? Your biggest turn on. What turns you on most, Stephanie and Caitlin?
Oh, I got this one.
Go ahead.
When he rubs my butt.
When he rubs your butt. That is
your biggest turn on.
Go ahead, Ronnie. Me. He said me. He says when you look at him.
That's your biggest turn on.
Holy fucking deal. What the fuck?
What,
I mean, Ronnie, what's going on here?
What do you mean? I answered the way I felt like answering.
You mean you think you're so hot that when she looks at you, that she's going to get turned on?
Well, if she doesn't, then there's a fucking problem.
Well, come on. She... All right.
He doesn't even understand the question.
No, I understand the question.
No, you don't. Say that.
All right, Caitlin, see if you can get 1 point on the board. What would your man say is your biggest turn on? Your biggest turn on.
I like when he just starts giving me head. It's just like a Saturday morning, and he kind of starts to wake me up a little bit with head.
When he goes down on you, and he just wakes you up with going down on
yes.
you. All right, Brent, come on, pal.
What's
do you got
on your
there?
Card, Brent? Is
what does
that
it say?
It?
I put
me in any sexual situation. Do you believe the fucking egos on these two guys? Caitlin, you're laughing. Why? Because it's absurd.
And it's so general. Like,
right.
how many things could fall into that category?
Ladies, you're doing a beautiful job of answering these questions. I do not fault you one bit. Both of these guys said basically they turn you on. I mean, it's crazy, yeah. Gary.
There's a big fight in the office, of course, but Matt is leading the charge because he wants to win, but he thinks that answer was correct.
No. She had a specific act in mind that turns her on.
She said when he goes down on her.
That's
Brent in a sexual
situation. But that, of course it is, but that's too fucking vague.
He said any sexual situation.
Go back to bed, you asshole.
Too general.
All right, I'll go to the judge. John, is that a match?
Howard, that is an incorrect answer.
Thank you.
There's the judge. All right.
And he's the judge.
Of course. Fucking Mehmet. Wait, who hired him?
You did.
Oh, you, I thought.
I made a mistake. So the way this happened, Mark, was the following. And we got to make a plan, okay?
Okay.
I'm yelling at Fred, because Fred is a good songwriter.
Yeah.
And I said, Fred, write me a fucking hit song.
Yeah.
So he went home and took me seriously. Wrote the song, sent it to me. I said, this sounds reasonable to me, this song. And I thought, like, maybe I could sing like that guy Fred Schneider in the B-52s, because he's just like, rock, bang, bang.
Yeah.
You know, like I could yell out some shit and have a hit song. I don't want to do much. We'll get a bunch of girls who can really sing.
Yeah.
I said to Baba Booey, I said, you got to get me one of these young, hot producers, somebody who's got some gravitas in the business, who knows what the kid's like.
Yeah.
So Gary called you immediately. I guess he had met you somewhere.
Yeah.
And you said yes. You weren't supposed to say yes.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, you fucked me up.
Yeah, I
now I'm all nervous.
I mean, I'm sure everyone comes on and says this, but like I grew up New York K-Rock listening every day on school. I'm a massive fan of the show. So when I got this text from my friend Ross, who worked at Sirius, saying, can I give Gary Dell'Abate your number? I was like, this is the coolest random text I've ever seen. Yes.
Yeah.
So we talk. He starts telling me about the song. He sends me the Fred demo, and it's cool. He wrote you a hit song.
Yes, of course.
And I think that, like, I think that we can really make something pretty great. I know what you mean about the Fred Schneider. I love Love Shack. I love the B-52s.
Yeah.
I think.
Well, let's make a deal.
Yeah.
I'm going to get in there today. I was practicing last night.
Okay.
I don't know what I'm doing.
You were practicing last night?
I was. Thank God Beth wasn't home. She was out.
Can I tell you something?
Yeah, like, give me some tips.
This is, in my experience as a producer, what I do, and it doesn't matter whether the artist is like
Bruno Mars
or Ghostface Killer or Gaga or Bradley, whoever I'm working with, everybody has a superpower, special talent. You have a voice that is the golden voice that millions of people love. I'm sorry.
I do? I mean, I do.
You just do. Just when you talk. So, like, all I have to do, I don't want to make you do anything that you don't usually do or whatever. Like, take that voice, that platinum thing anyway, and just make that the star of the show. And, like, that's why we're going to record it with your vocals, like, at this desk so you sound exactly like you do to the millions of people every day. Because, like, that's what we want to hear.
I like what you're saying. In other words, be myself.
Be yourself.
Don't get inhibited. Don't get uptight. Give the people what they want.
Give the people, say, you can make up what you've coined plenty of nonsense, amazing words and phrases. All we have to do is put those in. And then, you know, you said you wanted some girl parts. So I went, you know, the girls in the band Heim are big fans of the show.
I can't believe you got them to do the backups.
Listen, I mentioned
your name. Let Heim do the cover. Let them do the heavy lifting. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah. I called them up. I was like, what are you guys doing tomorrow? They're like, I don't know. We have this. We got press. I'm like, I'm working on this song for Howard Stern. They're like, we'll be there at 8:30.
Wow. Heim said that?
Yes. So like we made this song in a way that like, they'll sing the bits. You could say anything. You could say the stuff that Fred wrote. Fred wrote you a hit song. We can take a lot of those lyrics.
I might ad lib a little. Be prepared.
I want that.
I'm getting a little pumped up. I could see why you're valuable as a producer. You're starting to inspire me.
Well, it's just true. Like, you have something. You have a gift. All I have to do is, like, put that gift in a shiny bow and, like, put it on a nice beat.
And
can have a hit.
And don't be uptight about directing me. It's okay.
Yeah,
my ego is out the window. I am a... Robin, tell him I'm a professional.
He can leave his ego at
the door. I leave my ego at the door. I have no ego.
Okay.
My parents took care of that. I want you to know we do not intentionally post bad pictures of you. I heard we were being...
Oh, yeah. I don't know about that.
Yeah.
I don't know about that.
Mehmet now is claiming that there's a conspiracy against him here on our show.
Yeah.
Because we put out pictures all the time.
And that's true.
And you think that we're choosing bad pictures to make you look bad?
Yeah, dude. I don't look like the pictures they post.
But
first of all,
I don't think they're bad pictures.
Bad. No, they're bad, dude. Like, I swear to God, someone must search and try to find, like, the very moment I look my worst and post it on the website.
You can't win with you, dude. You're a paranoid dude.
They try to find
nobody's
me looking
doing
bald.
That.
They do. They do all that stuff.
Looking bald? You're not bald.
I know, but they find
how
a screenshot
they
of me.
How do they manage that?
Jason,
you know,
help
they
me
have
with
weird
this.
Angles.
Mehmet is completely crazy. First of all, his pictures look absolutely fine.
Right. I went they look like him.
And I was showing him pictures. I go, you just have normal pictures up of yourself.
On my Instagram, I look like me. On the website, I look
like
a monster.
No, Mehmet, on your Instagram, because I've taken pictures of you before for the website, what happens is you need 10 or 15 minutes to go into the green room, do your hair, fluff up. Then you want picture approval. That's when I do it. I give you that time. I don't think the website guys have all these time to either A, look for the worst picture for you, or necessarily the best picture for you.
Yeah, just
everyone
picture.
Looks really nice on the website.
Except you.
Nobody does.
Yeah,
it's the truth.
Nobody.
It's
but just because you don't.
They always
everybody
get me,
thinks their own pictures
no,
are
no,
bad.
No, no, no. They always get me in a pose where I look like a crazed maniac or something
wow.
like that.
Okay.
Instead, everyone else is just sort of smiling in their picture.
Honestly, I'm telling you, there's no conspiracy against you.
They did a newlywed game video. They put it out.
Yeah, but we're not doing that to
you. I found a really nice screen grab of me, and I posted it on my Instagram. That was easy to find.
I told you not to post on Instagram anymore. That
you said don't do politics.
Well, I don't think you should. I don't think you can handle anybody's comments.
I don't read the comments.
All right. All right.
But you have to post.
Yeah.
I'm a hot guy.
Mehmet's right. We every day, about 30 of us get together in a room. We throw out all the pictures of Mehmet we have. We, you know, try and figure out what the worst one of his is, and we put it up. I mean, we a lot
Jason
of time and effort
great
at work.
In the pictures. I mean, come on.
I think he would have been a great George Costanza, and you, in fact, auditioned for that role.
For that.
For Seinfeld.
I did.
Because they saw a lot of people for that
I remember
show.
I went in. And Jerry was there, and I was like, hi, Jerry's like, hey, hi, David. Okay, we're going to read. And I was like, okay, action. Hey, Jerry, so what are we going to do today? And he's like, I don't know, George. And they were like, God, I was like, this show is going to suck. I mean, this will never go. So I didn't get it. I mean, it's morphed into I was offered George Costanza. No, I auditioned for it.
Right.
But I left gladly. I was like, this
show. You didn't
show,
see it.
No.
No. When you saw it on TV and you did you go, oh, wow, it actually works?
No, I was like, shit, I should have been better. Why the fuck did I blow off that audition? I didn't blow it off.
Right.
But it was just like, so what? Right over my head.
Unbelievable.
I went to the opening and I sat next to Jim Carrey when he did, what was his first film?
Ace Ventura.
Ace Ventura.
Jeez.
So when I got to the opening, the theater, you know, his manager goes, I have a surprise. I'm going to sit you next to Jim. And I was like, fuck. Because Jim was so nervous.
Right.
He was literally crawling out of his skin. And I said, this is my friend. I'm going to support him today.
Right.
So I laughed until I was hoarse and my throat was dry because I wanted to support Jim.
Right. You wanted him to feel good.
Of course. In my head, I was like, again, no one's going to see this movie because he was too crazy.
Right.
There was one point in the movie where he's with his love interest, Courtney
Cox.
And I said, you know, for this 20 seconds, Jim is going to look at her and be serious. Like, he goes, you know, I really like you. I really like you, too. And she says something like, I really like you. And goes, yeah, 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 yeah. And I just went, he is insane. No one is going to buy this.
It's really true. It was so different and so out there.
Oh, yeah.
I could see why he would be nervous at the premiere, because he's probably like, I'm either going to fucking tank and my career is over. But that thing took off like crazy.
Well, again, so I see Chris Rock in the lobby.
Yeah.
And I go, Chris, who do you think? Chris goes, David, no one. We'll see this movie. Okay? Forget it. Now, again, right over my head, I was wrong. I was wrong.
Right.
I was wrong. I turned that movie down.
You turned down Ace Ventura?
They said, you and Rob Schneider will put you guys together. And I was like, no, thank you.
Meanwhile, the thing made $107 million.
Of course, it's many wrong turns that I've taken willingly in my career.
I know it drives you crazy, those kind of stories,
right? It does, but what are you going to do, man? I just remember, so like a year after Ace Ventura comes out, I'm at a friend's house, and his three-year-old, this little white kid, comes in the room. And the only thing this kid could do is he took a VHS copy of Ace Ventura. He could put it in the machine and he knew how to press play and then rewind. And he would watch it over and over again. And at that point, I realized this is a phenomenon. This is a cultural phenomenon that I have missed.
Hear such disturbing things during the show. It was really weird. Jason told me that in a bragging way that Richard, who works here, he only owns one pair of jeans, like one pair of pants, and he's owned them for 5 years, and he hasn't washed them in 5 years, and he wears them every day here to work. And those are including the days that he shit his pants here on the air. How disturbing. And then he's worried about his kid getting exposed to germs. How filthy are those pants?
Well, they must stand up on their own at this point.
And it's like, his teeth are falling out of his head, and you're smiling. It's like, I know you're proud of this, but dude, you don't wash.
Freeze it and Febreze it. That's what you got to do.
What does that mean?
You throw them in the freezer.
In your
kills
your,
the germs.
You put your when do you put your pants in the freezer?
Every couple of months or so.
But why wouldn't you just throw them in the washing machine?
It breaks down the fibers and they don't last
as long. Yeah, and then you get new pants.
Right.
These are expensive pants.
How much are those jeans?
A couple hundred.
What's a couple? You mean 200?
Maybe around 200, yeah.
And so in 5 years, you couldn't come up with another $200 for a pair of pants?
Yeah, just start saving now. Yeah,
I mean if they're starting to fall apart, so I might have to, but I might maybe get
them
sewed up.
That's the only pants you... Do you own a suit? If you have to go somewhere fancy?
Yeah, the suit that I wear to the Christmas party every year, yeah.
So you only own that pair of jeans and a suit?
Pretty much, yeah.
That's it.
A few shirts.
Yeah.
You're some button-up shirts. Disgusting. Like, your wife doesn't get disgusted?
She gets a little annoyed at my jeans in the freezer once in a while.
I would.
So why doesn't she just take them and throw them in the wash?
Because I'm always wearing them. There's really...
She'd have to throw him in the wash.
Yeah, she'd have to wash me.
Like, as a girl, does she ever say to you, it's disgusting?
No, she don't mind.
Really?
Uh-uh. That's why she's awesome.
Well, you don't mind holding the baby on your 2-month-old filthy pants?
I mean, you're the one who doesn't want the baby exposed to germs.
Certain germs.
Oh, but yours are okay.
Mine are good germs.
Oh, you're a fucking maniac, dude.
No one's buying you put them in the freezer to get rid of the germs.
Gary, he's not putting them in the freezer.
But even if he was, Richard, how does that get rid of the germs? At best, it would neutralize the germs. You think it freezes the germs away, and when you take them out, the germs are gone?
But why not just wash your pants? It's just as easy.
I'm just doing what they told me at the jeans store. They said, if you want these to last a really long time, you shouldn't wash them. You should put them in the freezer.
What they mean is they're saying if you want them to last a year. I mean, my God, Richard, that's disgusting. Seriously, man, you shit your pants on the show. You had shit your pants. And you don't say, now I really need to wash these. It could smell like shit.
There's a barrier. I had underwear on.
Oh, my God. Sal, that doesn't really gross you out, honestly? Like working in a room with a guy who doesn't wash his clothes?
Prevalent.
Sal shits his Prevalent. Farts all the time.
Yeah, but he washes his clothes, I assume.
I hope.
It's a little strange, but I don't mind.
Yeah. And first of all, where's the science that freezing kills germs? It doesn't.
Antarctica, doesn't have a lot of germs.
Freezing can kill germs.
Not all germs.
I don't know that it kills everything.
Robin, look at this. According to the Smithsonian, freezing jeans doesn't kill germs. I guess that's a thing. Wash you work with people. Wash your clothing.
They don't stink. You want to smell them?
No.
No.
Howard, he definitely shits his pants more than you think because there are times when he farts and then he waddles out of the office to the bathroom really quickly.
And he wears boxers, so you know some of that shit's falling into the pants.
No, I stopped wearing boxers because of that.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
But those are the same pants you used to wear boxers with.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So they've got years of old shit. Now you've heard that it doesn't kill germs.
I might just get new jeans now. Yeah.
What a weird life. How much are jeans? I'm just going to buy you a pair of jeans. You're fucking
Well, I'm
cheap.
Particular about my jeans. That's the thing. These are like wearing sweats. They're so comfortable.
Yeah, well, get the same brand then. What is that? What kind of jeans?
Diesel.
Diesel?
I'll probably
go.
I'll
so
probably
go on the Diesel website and get a pair of jeans.
Why not get a couple?
Yeah.
Well, $200 each.
I mean, a second pair of jeans, backup jeans, why not?
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you.
I'll treat myself.
All right, good.
Thanks.
It's annoying. Get out of here. What was the story with the dating? Weren't you? Tell me if I have this right.
Mm-hmm.
You were going to date Sarah Silverman's sister or something?
Well,
you got to tell that story because I don't really fully understand it.
Okay, here's what happened. There was a period when Jimmy Kimmel had guest co-hosts.
Yes.
So I was one of those guys. Been friends with Jimmy for a while.
Jimmy loves you.
I love Jimmy very dearly. He's one of the sweetest men. You know that.
He's the best.
So I did my week with him, and that was when he was with Sarah Silverman. At one point, Sarah said, listen, my sister Laura has a crush on you.
Right.
Are you single? I said, yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
So I go to answer like yes. Right. And so I said, yeah, I am
What was the yes? In other words, you feel Sarah's an attractive woman.
I knew Sarah.
You were looking for love.
Yeah, I was single. single. I mean, I was, you know, between relationships, I was just hanging around.
And is that the sister who's the rabbi, or is that the
That's her older sister.
That's her older sister. Okay.
I believe Laura's her younger sister.
Oh,
and
very
she said
nice.
Her name's Laura. This is my sister. And Sarah was like, I don't know. You seem to be out there. And I was like, not at all. How dare you?
I'm a virgin.
Exactly. I'm looking for a nice Jewish girl.
Right.
So she hooked us up. We email, we talk on the phone, we're going to go out.
Right.
And by happenstance, a day or two before this date, I run into this porn star, this very, very famous porn star, who's like made it clear she wants to go out with me. And I'm like, oh, okay. And
like my ship has sailed.
Exactly.
Come in.
Yeah. So it was the same night that Laura and I were supposed to go out. So I just emailed her, my mom's really sick. I can't go out.
Because you can't turn down a porn star.
I just figured, I didn't know what's going to happen with but you got to go out with the porn star.
Right.
I mean, that's a given. You got to.
At some later time, you can contact.
Hey, I thought I could double back around. Me and Laura, get them tests, boom, boom.
Right. I understand. Yes.
So I go to this Japanese restaurant with this porn legend, you know.
Legend.
She's a big porn star.
Wow.
I got to do it. So we're there. Oh, we hang out. Now, that leads to a relationship. Like, we hung out for about 6 months.
The porn star.
Yes.
No kidding. Were you nervous about the performance in front of a porn star?
I was so nervous.
Yeah.
That I started taking Viagra that very night.
Really?
Yes. Now, this is a woman.
How old were you at that point?
I could have been, what? Okay, so 2003?
Yeah. All right, so it's 2003. It's not that long ago.
No, but I was just for insurance.
No shit.
Oh, yeah. So she came to see me perform. We would hang out.
You mean you had no trouble getting it up, and you said, you know what? Just in case. I better have a backup on this.
This is legendary.
This is a professional.
Yeah, and so she would do.
Oh,
okay. The first time we hook up, she gave me this blowjob. It was a porno film performance.
You're kidding.
Yes.
You mean there was a big difference?
A big difference?
Wow.
It was like, Howard, it was so fucked up, man. I didn't spend the night. We hung out like all the way. I got home at like 4 a.m. and I called my brother and I was crying on the phone.
Crying.
I said, we've been lied to. This is the most incredible in my life. I have never. No, I was used to blowjobs where if all else fails, yeah. I'll blow you. I never dated that girl who had to suck your dick.
Wow.
No, just never happened for me.
Oh,
I mean,
my God.
I got blowjobs, but
I can take it or leave it.
Hey, man, this was a whole nother level.
A whole nother level.
So at one point, though, you know, I'm with her. We're hanging out. And she says, after we get through fucking, she goes, I want to get you some Viagra, man, so we can go like marathon fucking. I'm like, that was the Viagra. So at
Sorry.
That point, yeah, I didn't tell her, but I'm like, I'm fucked. So I had to like, you know what?
You should take it to Viagra.
Hey, man.
Yeah.
I broke up with her because I was like, I can't keep this up.
Yeah, in other words, it was too much. You couldn't handle the sex.
Well, think about it.
Did you think?
How many years have you been in radio?
Oh, my God, like almost 40 years
okay,
now.
Okay, well, imagine if you dated a woman who put in 30, 40 years of fucking. That was her expertise. That is the part in her life that she has down.
She's in a whole nother league.
Oh, yeah.
So you're telling me porn stars really are experts in...
She was.
She put in her 10,000 hours.
Yes. Okay,
oh
so now wait, to circle back around to Laura.
Yeah.
So right. I say, Laura, I can't, you know, my mom, I told you my mom was sick. And so she emails me back after the proposed date. And she said, my sister, the rabbi, saw you at the restaurant with this porn star.
Oh, my God.
So I know you're full of shit.
Oh.
And so that's what ruined that. Now, first of all, why does your rabbi sister even know this woman is a porn star?
Listen,
like, I was ID'd immediately.
Oh,
she said
what are the odds of you being in a restaurant and Sarah Silverman's older sister sees you when you're supposed to be on a date with the younger sister?
Yeah. Okay.
What the fuck are the odds of that? Congratulations on this Bradley Cooper Lady Gaga song, because I think it's fantastic that Bradley Cooper has the number one song.
It's crazy.
I mean, he's not known for singing.
No. And also, because you know Bradley, he's on the show a lot. Like, he's such a modest guy. Like, he's not, I don't get the fact, like, some of us, like, they're Googling our chart positions. Like, that's not him.
Right.
So, like, every now and then when I see it's like number one, it's like, and it's not like we're super close, but I'll send him a text and be like, do you understand? Like, you have like the number one single. In it. Like, I've had the number one single like once before in my life, once with Bruno Mars.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
So like, I'm like, you and Bruno are my muses. Like, you are obviously the only way I can get to number one Bradley Cooper singer.
It is crazy because I do know Bradley Cooper. And yeah. I remember when he first started shooting A Star Is Born, I was invited to his home.
Yeah.
He says, I want to show you something. He showed me some clips of him singing in the early stages of filming the movie.
Yeah.
And he says, I want to know what you think. Because, you know, I was a judge on America's Got Talent. You know, people want to know my thoughts, Robin. So I said to him, you know, and I wasn't blowing smoke up his ass.
Yeah.
I'm pretty legit.
Yeah.
I said to him, I got to tell you, that's you singing? He goes, yeah. I go, I think people will believe that you can sing.
Yeah.
I mean, it sounds really good.
It sounds really good. We did some stuff like early on in the studio. I mean, you know, Gaga produced really most of it. It's like her vision. But we were in the studio. He was wanted to see what his voice was like, explore it. We recorded like a Green Day song.
Did he ever sung before? When he recorded the Green Day song, could he pull it off?
Yeah, it was great. And then he did like this Radiohead and this lovely falsetto. I mean, I have these. If I ever get hard up for money, TNC, I've got the Lost Bradley Cooper demos.
Right.
But no, and he does. And the other thing is, he loves music so much that I think it was like such a labor of love to like get it right. Like when I sometimes see movies, like I'd be like, oh, that's not really how they do it, or
right,
you know, for, like, and he just like made sure that it was just like bulletproof, like the him playing, it's so legit.
Tell me how that works. So who contacts you? Does Lady Gaga contact you and say, look, I'm doing A Star Is Born?
She created all the music, but working with someone like her, like 80% of it's in her head. Like you're just there to like, you know, maybe offer a chord, a lyric, but
she's a genius.
And the voice, the songs, the visions. I had worked with her on our album, Joanne.
Right.
And we had got close working on that. I knew her 10 years ago when she just started, like when she'd just come out with Just Dance, but hadn't seen her for 10 years. We worked together on Joanne. And then
you're a good looking guy. I imagine these women, they all come on to you too, right? I mean, you have to bat them off with a stick?
No, I was married. And no,
oh, you were?
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah, it's all right.
Sorry.
I mean, you know, I'm just imagining, you know, when you're working with a woman.
Yeah.
And you're that intimate and you're listening to her voice and, you know, someone as powerful as Lady Gaga, I figure maybe it turns romantic or something, you know?
I turn into like uncle or dad real quick. So that's kind of, yeah, I think
so. I'm so sorry.
I know.
Right. Yeah, I'm sorry you're so professional. I knew I was going to win some money on the Super Bowl. I just didn't know how much.
Yeah.
I thought I was going to win everything.
I thought I'd bet a lot more.
Yeah.
Thank goodness I didn't.
I have seemed to have won most of my money from you.
Yes.
Let me see how much I got here. 20, 40, 60, 80, 100. 20, 40, 60, 80, 100. 20, 40, 50.
$250.
Yeah, you know, someone else must owe me money.
Yeah, I wasn't the only one who lost to you.
Who else owes me money?
Howard, I have the tape of Jackie and Robin betting.
Yeah.
And it's sort of weird. I mean, I guess it's a bet. You know, things were going sort of fast. But Jackie says, I got $100, says Green Bay will score first. And Robin says, I say New England will score first. And then nobody said anything after.
Yeah, they didn't take
the bet. I mean, I'll play it for you and you can decide.
Nah, it sounds like it's a push.
I don't know. I don't remember the bet. And hey, it didn't get written down.
Robin just said, like, nobody ever said, okay, we're set on that then. Robin just said, oh, I say New England scores first.
All I know is it. Baba Booey missed a lot of the bets.
No, I didn't. What else did I miss?
I bet a couple of people. I gave him 14 points.
Yeah, I know he had a 14.
Even though it's a push, but I made a bunch of bets.
There were lots of bets, and we have to say, like, I definitely bet. Like, Jackie just threw it out there.
No, you know what it is? You're type B, and type B people
are sluggish
and don't care. Yeah. Like, I would have been, if I was the guy in charge, I would have been so anal retentive. I would have said, okay, stop. You bet what?
I was
you
saying that. You guys don't listen to me.
Well, I don't know. No,
you want to hear that?
No, you're...
I go, whoa, wait a minute.
You're type B.
Yeah, yeah.
And you know what a type A does? He goes back and listens to the tape and checks his work.
Yeah.
Right?
We went over all the bets even on the air.
Type
I said, okay,
a,
we're all set.
Type Everyone. A goes, because you missed them. You missed bets.
How could we have gone over all the bets and if that bet didn't get in and nobody questioned?
You can listen to this bet.
A type A goes back
Howard,
and checks
listen
the
listen to the bet.
Or a type A says one of the interns, go back and check all
Howard,
my work.
I don't think I'm a type A and I don't care
I know
if I'm
you're
a type
not.
A because you're a type A hole.
No, you're not a type A. You're not a type A.
You're an A and an
A-hole. No, it's not a put down.
It is a
type
B. It's a put down.
You're not a type A. You're not one of those people who's meticulous.
Why don't you say
you're type
B? Right, you're not meticulous. You're sloppy.
Oh, I see. You're getting insulted.
It is an insult.
It's in your genetics. Either you're a type A or you're a type B.
Monkey.
Yeah.
And B isn't necessarily bad. You're going to live a lot longer.
Okay, Jackie. You know what? For being a jerk, it's up between you and Robin. Try getting your $100 out of her. Go get it.
I already gave up on it.
Good. Then don't worry about it.
A type A lives less or will die sooner because they worry about everything. They're compulsive. They're people who, that's why they're mostly successful, type A's. Type A's are your high-powered, successful people.
Yeah, they're people who stroke out or have a heart attack at 50.
A type B is like a Gary who will always live under the wing of a type A.
He'll live to be 100.
Right, and he will live a long time. He will be the guy who writes the book eventually.
He'll be the guy, yes, that's who does all the video biographies.
Right, but the book will be real bad because he's a type B. And it'll be like, he wouldn't have taken meticulous notes. He'll just have, he'll just have to rely on his memory.
His stories about the great person he worked with will be very vague.
Yeah, and the book will
be
all wrong.
My stories about you will be very detailed. Very detailed.
He'll be a type A when it comes to you.
I've been keeping notes in my computer.
Oh, shifted in type A.
every time you make fun of me, Robin, I put it in my computer.
I have never made fun of
verbatim.
You. Right. I have never made fun of you. What have you got in that computer?
No, but a type B will live a lot longer. You will see. Gary will outlive everyone because to him, it's like, I'll take some bets. And whatever I get. Whenever I don't. It's
no
big deal.
I'll tell you how you know a type A from a type B. Yeah. Type A was sitting next to type B on the plane. Type A was working. Type B was sleeping.
Right. And Robin, type B had his mouth open and drool coming out of it.
I only woke up working. I woke up for orange juice. Right. What work were you doing on that plane trip?
I was doing a lot of work.
You couldn't sleep. That was your work.
No. My mind is very active when burning up with a lot of different things.
That.
Plotting and planning the next moves for us while you rest.
Robin, you're a type what?
I'm a type C.
What does that mean?
You got that
I know
right.
That. Yeah, you're right.
You got that right.
See you next Tuesday.
Noine.
Are you upset that you didn't win?
I don't know where you think just you turns
dude,
me
you
on.
You got nothing to fucking
we
say.
We stand in the kitchen, he rubs my butt all the time.
You have nothing to say because you fucking ruined the show. Get the fuck out of here. Get out. Because you ruined the show.
Who are you
show.
Talking to? My man.
Yeah. This is why I say
now he's a big shot because he won by 1 point.
Yeah.
Get the fuck out, my man. We don't even want to fucking hear you.
But Matt, Jesus. Why are you here? What do you have to say?
I'm just here to gloat. Right. Never bet against me.
No,
I'm
you just
always
said
right. I'm
no
always
shit.
10 steps ahead
now he's, now
of
he's
all
a
of
big
you.
Shot.
Dude, I mean, it's pretty bad. 1 point after 12 years
dude,
of marriage?
Here's what I'm fucking telling you, dude. You just said 2 minutes ago that
you.
Brent was worthless. He didn't know what he was talking about. They
I'm
didn't
just
know
trying
each
to get
other.
In your head.
And now
I want to thank you for the Del Frisco dinner that me and
you're
Barry are going to have.
Total
and
asshole.
Robin, I can't wait to see those $200, which I'm sure you have ready.
I do.
Well, you did win. I got it. I can't stand that.
I always win. When will you guys realize that? I always win.
Except when you're
anything I do. No one will ever beat me.
All
thank
right.
you. Thank
stop
you
stop being
all.
An asshole about it. You won. Big deal. I mean, you won by 1 point.
He's running,
but I knew you would lose. You fucked up on my name. I fucked you again. Right. I may look like Pee Wee Herman, but you look like an inbred Papa Smurf. You stupid, limp dick old
you know,
asshole.
Even the Chris Wilding one, that should have been a slam dunk.
That should have.
That should have
Hate
been.
Me more now?
All right.
Fuck you. Brent and Caitlin, I love you.
All
thank
right.
God
thank you. Thank you.
What a nightmare.